Robotics and artificial intelligence seem like things that will help us in a far-off future. But roboticist Brenna Argall is using that technology to help people right now. Take a look. Robots already help build our cars and clean our homes. They're starting to deliver our packages, bring us dinner, and even provide entertainment. But the next stage of the robotics and artificial intelligence revolution has the potential to do so much more. Unlocking that future will take the work of mechanical engineers, computer scientists, and roboticists. People like Dr. Brenna Argall, she does all three of those things and more.
We now see computers everywhere, and it's sort of the next step that your computer now is doing something in the world. We call it actuating. You're actuating the world. You're making it move. You're moving within it. For a machine to do that on its own or to do that in partnership with another human is just really, really interesting, really cool.
Brenna runs a research laboratory at the Shirley Ryan AbilityLab Rehabilitation Hospital in Chicago, where her team is designing the next generation of medical assistive devices.
We add robotics autonomy, so think driverless car technology, to assistive machines like powered wheelchairs and robotic arms. And we do this in order to make operating assistive devices like these more accessible to people with very severe motor impairments.
While many people with lower level spinal cord injuries can use a joystick to control their wheelchair, people with higher level injuries might only be able to control their machine via switches in the chair's headrests, or even breathing through a sip and puff interface. So Brenna's team has to take all of this into consideration when designing new technology.
When we talk about robotics autonomy, we often say driverless cars, but for the technology we have in this chair, the better parallel is actually just the intelligence that we see in today's regular automobiles. We have things like lane assist, emergency braking, parallel parking. That kind of technology is what we want to bake into this machine.
For people unable to operate a powered wheelchair reliably or safely, this technology could be a game changer. But even those who have mastered their chair's limited interfaces could benefit, as Brenna's about to demonstrate.
So now I'm going to go down this ramp and start taking the obstacle course, and I'm going to be using this head array interface in order to drive the chair. So you can see if I tap my head backwards, I go forwards. And then if I want to turn, I tap to the left. Now I'm going to go forward, and I'm going to need to go around this obstacle. So I have to stop and turn, stop and turn. That's how this interface operates.
Now Brenna engages the robotics autonomy and takes on the course a second time.
So what you're going to be able to see now is I'm just going to drive forward. You'll see that I'm not turning my head to the left or the right, but the chair stops for me. And it actually drove me around as well. Now I need to give it a cue again that I want to go this way, giving a control signal to the left, but I didn't actually need to navigate that obstacle myself or stop myself.
This autonomy intelligence framework is an autopilot. The chair is taking direction from the user, scanning the environment using 3D sensors and deciding how to get the driver where they want to be. Without the robotics autonomy engaged, even small tasks can take a lot of effort.
So now I'm going to try to get through the door. But you can see here that I'm needing to tap quite a bit. Even without having a motor impairment and the full use of my neck and shoulders, I find this pretty tiring.
And now Brenna will give the forward motion cues while the chair corrects itself.
Here we go. So right now the chair is trying to find a safe path through the door. It found it, and now it's turning left and right to get us through. You see how much easier that was that time. I didn't need to do any of this left-right tapping to align myself to navigate through that tight doorway squeeze. Different people want different amounts of assistance. They don't want a 100% autonomous driverless wheelchair. They want a shared control wheelchair. And getting that shared control sharing right is tough. It's actually where a lot of our research lies, is trying to figure out what is the right way to share control between the machine and the human. And we're really excited about the potential of that technology.